thank you so much for letting us come and worship with you this morning. For the next 40 to 45 minutes, we're going to be hammering on some strings. We're going to sing you some songs, and we're going to be telling you some stories in between. And we're going to start it out with a song that's been around for a long, long time. It's called Unclouded Day.
So as we travel each weekend, a lot of times folks like to know what we do for a living. Normally we just do this on the weekends, about 48 or 49 weekends out of the year. We pack everything up at the end of the week and head to different parts of the country. This is really close to home. We're only about 3 hours away. Last weekend it was South Dakota. Don works with wood. He builds cabinets and furniture and things like that. And for about 19 years or so now, he's been building these musical instruments full time. Folks were often asking where they could get these old-fashioned Bible instruments. So he started out building a psaltery. You know how the Bible talks about the psaltery and the harp? Well, that little triangle-shaped one that I played with a bow is a psaltery. And he built two of them. And the very next weekend, the Lord blessed and he sold them both. So he kept building more. I think he's working on number 452 or so right now. Each one has a little different tone because of the type of wood and the sound hole design. He also builds the mountain dulcimer like I'll play on my lap. He builds hammer dulcimers. This is not one that he built. We just got back from a big trip out west, and we took two with us, and the Lord blessed him. He sold both of them. So he's in the wood shop making another one, and I'm playing this older one. So I may hit wrong notes. It's smaller, and it's missing a few notes, so just bear with me. And then he also builds zithers. After a while, we'll hold them up so you get a better look at them. My part is to help put the strings on. And I'm a nurse. Actually, I retired from being a nurse practitioner about a year ago. And so now we don't have to go home every single week for me to go back to work. So we're thankful for that. Well, a few years ago, we were out west driving toward Arizona. And somewhere on I-40 between Grants and Gallup, New Mexico, I looked up in the sky and there was a sun dog. Have you ever seen that before? little rainbow that's by the sun sometimes? Well, it was bright and beautiful colors. And it reminded me when I was growing up as a child on the farm there in Iowa, I used to ask my dad about things like that because he knows a lot about nature. I said, "Dad, what does that mean when there's a little rainbow like that?" And he said, "Well, if the sun dog is on the north, it's going to get colder. And if the sun dog is on the south, it's going to get warmer." Well, one day I saw a double sun dog. It was going on both sides. So I said, "Dad, what does that mean?" And he said, "Well, that means it's either going to get warmer or it's going to get colder." Well, what does it take to make a rainbow? Two things. Water and light. Yeah. And the way that the rays of light go through the droplets of moisture, it spreads out the spectrum and we see the beautiful colors. And that reminds me of a scripture. In Psalm 85:10, it says, "Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other." It takes both, doesn't it? Mercy and truth, like two sides of the same coin. Righteousness and peace, law and grace. And they all come together at the cross, where Jesus willingly laid down his life for our sins, because he loves us so much. Here's our sense of vanity and pride, hearing of my Lord is crucified, knowing that it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great, and grace was free. Pardon there was love denied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary.
And I would watch it, and every once in a while that flap its wings, but it still wouldn't fly. So I went right up to the window. Now, the bird feeder's about 4 feet from the window. I went up to the window. I watched that bird for a while. He flapped his wings. He jumped a little bit, but he still wouldn't fly away. So I got my shoes on, and I walked down on the deck, went right up to that bird feeder, and here that little chickadee had got its head stuck right between the two bars where the seats come out. He could have flapped his wings all day, folks. He wasn't going to go anywhere. So I grabbed the holding with my right hand, and with my left hand, I opened up the back of that bird feeder, and I wiggled his little head out between those two bars, made sure he was okay, and when I opened up my hand, he flew and landed about 3 feet from me on our railing, and he turned around and looked at me. No, he didn't talk to me. But if he could, he probably would have said, thank you. Thank you for getting me out of the situation I got myself into. You know, kindness works on everything. Everybody needs a try, a little kindness.
In Seattle, gonna stand in front of the road with a heavy load, from the seas he's so. Following by the way, just stop and say, you're on the wrong way. You've got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, shine a light for anyone to see. And if you try a little kindness, then you're over the line of the middle of my life.
His name was Tom, and Tom was an artist, and he painted beautiful pictures with such detail. He lived most of his life in Minnesota, so most of his pictures were winter scenes. I think they have two seasons up there, July and winter. And there's so much amazing detail, and so much joy just comes through these pictures. But the most amazing thing about my uncle's talent, he said he didn't have the use of his arms or his legs. He was a victim of multiple sclerosis, and from about 40 years old, he was a quadriplegic, not using his arms or legs, in a wheelchair. And before the disease struck him, he had taught math concepts at Maplewood Academy in Minnesota, and he loved working with the young people, and it got so bad he couldn't teach anymore, and that broke his heart. And one day he was watching TV on a public channel, and he saw that they were teaching handicapped people how to paint. And so from watching that show, he learned to paint with a paintbrush in his mouth. And as the disease got worse over his life, he got so bad he couldn't even move his neck. So his precious wife would move the canvas and put paint on the brush so he could paint. We don't live in a world where things are fair, do we? My grandma and grandpa had 9 kids, and they raised them all for the Lord. And by the time my grandma died, only 3 were Christians, and that broke her heart. I remember I was sitting there with her in the nursing home, and she was just crying. She said, "My kids." I said, "I know, Grandma, but think about your grandkids. Many, many of us learned about Jesus from Grandma." And that gave her a little joy. And since the time that she died, almost all of the rest of her kids have come back to the Lord, too. And we're not giving up on the rest of them yet, either. The Lord doesn't promise us an easy life here, does he? Tom was only one of 3 that stayed true to the Lord, and then he had to be stricken with this disease. But the Lord says, "My peace I give you, not like the world gives." Another artist was asked to paint a picture of peace. What would you paint? Maybe a beautiful Tennessee sunset or a mountain scene? Well, this artist painted a picture of a raging thunderstorm. And in the midst of the storm, on a little twig, was a bird singing her heart out for joy in the midst of the storm. I think that's perfect peace, don't you? It's the peace that my uncle had. I never heard him say any discouraging word. Always it was praise to the Lord. And like we were studying in Sabbath school today, our God inhabits the praises of Israel. And he can take a bad situation, and if we'll pray, he can turn it into something good. Thank you.
You tell us what it is, okay? How about this one right here? Anybody?
A fish guitar.
A fish guitar. How about, what? Did anybody say it? It's called a dulcimer. Anybody heard of a dulcimer? Okay, you've heard of a dulcimer. Well, this one's called a mountain dulcimer or lap dulcimer because you play it on your lap. The difference between the mountain dulcimer and the lap dulcimer is when you're in the mountains, it's a
mountain
dulcimer. Very good, yes. And when you're on the flatlands, it's a lap dulcimer. That's the only difference between the two. How about this one right here? A mandolin. That is a custom-made mandolin. Donna's brother is building mandolins, and he built that one for us. And we're glad he did because we enjoy playing it. How about this one right here? It's in the Bible. Starts with a P.
Psaltery.
Very good. That is called a bowed psaltery, just like they talk about in the Book of Psalms. They talk about a psaltery and a harp and some of the other instruments that King David played. That is a psaltery. Everywhere we go, we always tell everybody, that's the psaltery that David played. We're talking about our son, David, is who we're talking about. How about this one right here? Starts with a Z.
Dulcimer.
No, starts with a Z. Psaltery, I think somebody said it. It's called a zither is what it's called. They started building the instruments back in the late 1800s. And all you do on a zither is you pluck the notes. Early 1900s, they came out with an auto harp, and some of you know what an auto harp is. And actually, the auto harp took the place of the zither because they made it easier for folks to play. How about the one right here in front Donna was hammering on? It's another dulcimer, and she was doing what with it? Hammering. Very good. Hammer dulcimer is what it's called. And we're going to go ahead and do a song called Lily of the Valley. And Donna's going to start it with the zither, go to the psaltery, and then into the hammer dulcimer. Now, folks, if she gets a little excited, one of these instruments comes flying your way, you catch it, all right? Because we don't want it to fall and break on the floor. We was out in Arizona here a while back, and it was a really long church. And there was a gentleman standing sitting way in the back, and he hollered out, "If we catch it, can we keep it?" No. You have to give it back to me to finish the program. Donald's been pretty good, though. There's nothing been flying. This is really the balance. of the things Donald and I really enjoy doing, and that is going to the schools and showing the children the instruments, tell them a little bit about them, and then playing the instruments for them. And we were out in California here about 5 years ago, and we had about 15 concerts or so out there, and the music teacher at the Christian schools found out we were in the area and said, would you come over and show the children the instruments? We said, we'd love to do that. And he had grades 1 through 8, and every hour he'd have a different class. And he'd stand them outside the door, and he'd tell them, I have a special treat for you today. And then he'd let them come in. And they'd come in, they'd sit down, they were very quiet, and then we'd play the instruments, tell them about the instruments, and then do some more playing for them. And it was the fourth grader's turn. He stood them outside the door and told them, I have a special treat for you today. And one of the little fourth grader boys raised his hand and said, is it muffins? And he said, well, you'll find out when you get in there. And we were playing the instruments, and they came in. They were really quiet, and they sat down. We told them about the instruments, played some more for them. And then it was their turn to leave. And as they were way out, the little guy went up to his teacher and said, this was better than muffins. So that was the day we found out that we were better than muffins. So we're going to go ahead and do a song that we did for them. And Donald will play all four of the instruments. Shall We Gather at the River? Thank you. just have two more songs to do before we want to say thank you again for letting us come and worship with you. We do hope at least one of the songs so far has touched and blessed you in some way.
Isn't it wonderful to be part of the family of God? And we have family all over the country. And we are so excited that we have gotten to meet Allison when we were first, I guess, see again, when we were first Christians. Her mom and dad and all six of their kids were such an influence on us. It's because of their love and their kindness to us that we are still Christians, I'm sure. And Allison was just a tiny little baby, 1 year old, I think, when we first met. And our son Daniel, who is turning 45 tomorrow, is just a year older. So those two, a little younger. And so those two kind of were babies together. So it's just so good to see Allison. And you know, I think she lived in Tennessee, so now we're hoping for more chance to get better acquainted and hear more about the family. Well, a few years ago, our son Danny, who's just turning 45 tomorrow, he was recommitting his heart to the Lord. When he got into high school, he started making choices that led him away from the Lord. And later on in his early 20s, he started thinking about how he missed that fellowship with Jesus, and he was reading Fox's Book of Martyrs. Not such an easy thing to read, huh? And another book called The Great Controversy. And as he was reading these stories of these great men and women of God who stood up and gave testimony to their faith, even at the risk of their own lives, something was puzzling him. How did those great men and women of God know the words to say that would ring through the centuries? How did Martin Luther know to say as he stood before the diet, "It is unsafe for a man to speak against his conscience. Here I stand. I can do no other." Well, Daniel pondered that for a while. And then he found that verse in the book of Matthew that says, "Don't plan ahead of time what you're going to say when you're called to give testimony to your faith. The Holy Spirit will give you the words at that time." And so Daniel wrote this song. And when he sang it for us, it touched our hearts. Sisters and brothers, we know as we look around the world that we're living in today, that the things that Jesus said would happen just before he comes back are happening all around us. And not just in the political world or the financial world or the natural world, but even in our own churches. And Jesus said, when you begin to see these things come to pass, look up and lift up your heads. Your redemption draws nigh. But between now and the time when Jesus comes back, it will not be easy for those who love him. And the time will come, maybe even has come, when each one of us will be called to give testimony to our faith. Maybe not in the words that we say, but in the lives that we live. And the only way we're going to be able to stand up and be counted for Jesus is if we surrender our hearts to him moment by moment. Spend time studying his word and prayer, sharing himself with others. And if he brings something to our heart that we're holding on to that's separated between us and him, we're saying, "Oh, Father, please take that too. I don't want there to be anything between me and you, so that we may stand, come what may." I
To be like them is my desire. Help me stand for you, my queen.
Help me with this. Come what may. Though they take me to the stake, peace is mine for Jesus' sake. It's all worth it just to come. Neonatal intensive care unit. In fact, I used to teach students for about 20 years, and I would take them to labor and delivery and to neonatal ICU, and I enjoyed that very much. And then I became a nurse practitioner, and about 5 years ago or so, we were looking at retirement, and we thought, we have a granddaughter in Nashville, and we have another granddaughter in southern Missouri, so we need to somehow locate between those two little gals. So we decided that we would settle in West Tennessee, and it's a perfect place to live. Tennessee is God's country, isn't it? And we love being Tennesseans. And it was only, Springfield, Missouri is about 6.5 hours from where we decided to live there near Scotts Hill. And I only had 4 more years until I could retire, and I thought, no problem, I'll just commute. You know, 4 years, it's not that long. 6.5 hours each way, and it got old really fast. So I decided maybe I should find something closer to home. Well, over in Decatur County, they used to have a hospital, little tiny rural hospital there in Parsons, and it had about 5 hospital beds, and it had a clinic associated with the hospital, and it had an emergency department. We're not too far from I-40, and sometimes the evening got kind of busy. And so they had a need for a nurse practitioner in their clinic, and so I applied and I was hired. And the clinic wasn't always very busy, and sometimes they needed some help over at the ER. And so I told them I could help now and then. One day I was over there helping, and the ambulance call came in. And they said, we're bringing in a young gal, maybe she's 15 or 16 years old, and she just delivered her baby. And she was all by herself, way out in the woods, and this baby is way too early, and he is not doing well. So I got together what we had, just a little warmer, some oxygen, and called Jackson and said, please get the helicopter in the air, we have a sick baby coming. And so when the ambulance arrived, the baby came to me, and I did what you do. I gave him oxygen, and I stimulated his little muscles, and warmed him up, and prayed, Lord, please save this little boy. And all of a sudden, he turned pink from head to toe. And his little muscles got strong, and he let out a big yell. And I knew he was going to be okay. And things settled down, and I had opportunity to take a look at his young mama. And another nurse practitioner was taking care of her. And she looked so young and so scared. And this other nurse practitioner was being just as rude as she could be, screaming into this young face, you selfish thing, how could you do this? It's all about the baby. What drugs are you on? And my heart went out to that young girl. And I thought, there, but for the grace of God, go on. How do I know that if my life had been just like her life, that that might be me laying there wondering, my little son would survive. How much is one soul worth? The only way to estimate the worth of one soul is to look at the price that Jesus was willing to pay for one. He would have left heaven and gone to that cross if only one of us would have needed his saving grace. He loves us that much.
Amen.
And when Jesus looks at us, he doesn't primarily see our sin. He sees what we can become by his grace if we'll just surrender our hearts to him. You hear his voice of love, my son, give me thine heart. How much is one soul worth? Well, someone wrote a poem about the worth of a soul, and this author compared it to an old violin that came up for auction. And to the people at the auction, it looked worthless until the master violinist came forward and tuned up the strings and played a beautiful melody with the old instrument. And it made all the difference because of the touch of the master's hand. But we are from West Tennessee, and we don't have very many violins where we come from. But we do have a lot of fiddles. Problem is the word fiddle doesn't fit, so we thought about it. And the word mandolin fits perfectly. So we're going to sing about the worth of a soul and the old mandolin. Now who's got a bit of a soul?
grass, you can go ahead and start digging in your pockets and your pocketbooks, because I'm going to pass this around for a love offering to show them our appreciation. One of the biggest blessings that I've had in my life, I've had a lot of blessings, but one of the blessings that I had is I used to spend a lot of time with this guy who was a staunch atheist in the worst way. And we used to eat together a lot and go to different restaurants, spend a lot of time together. And one day we were leaving a plaza, and at the end of the plaza there was a guy there taking up money, you know, we'll work for food and the sign and the whole nine yards. And I gave him some money. And he got so mad. He says, "What are you? Are you stupid? Are you stupid?" He says, "He's going to spend that money on whatever." And I said, "That's not my business. That's the Lord's business." And we were eating at a restaurant. And, of course, I always leave a tip for the waitress or the waiter because I appreciate the service and I understand that. And he would complain about that. "Why did you tip that? Why did you give them that much? What are you?" And sometimes, you know, you go to a place and the waitress would not be so great, or they would miss something. And he used to taunt me. He'd say, "What are you going to give that one? What are you going to do with that one?" And it occurred to me after a while, he just didn't want to give nothing to anybody. He didn't want to give nothing to anybody. And I thought to myself, you know, that's the difference. A Christian should be a cheerful giver, a person who loves to give and loves to share. And most of all, loves to show our appreciation for different things. And so, I'm going to go ahead and pass this around. And I know the pastor's going to close with closing prayer. And he's going to give us our church announcements. And so, but whatever the Lord puts in your heart to give. Because I know they travel a lot. And they got gas. And they got a van. And they're really at a lot of expense to move around and do the stuff that they do. And I would love to be a blessing for them to come here and just to show how much we appreciate it. So thank you.
How many of you enjoyed that today?
Amen.
Amen. Yes, let's applaud. Yes. Amen. Thank you. As that comes around, I hope you have a generous heart. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of music, for how much it can touch our soul, and how much it can sometimes be the thing that changes our lives. Father, we thank you for Don and Donna and for their ministry. We pray that you will continue to watch over them, keep them healthy, keep them safe. And we just thank you that they were willing to share with us today. Father, we thank you for the great blessing of bringing you into our lives in a small way today. And we just praise you so much for your great love and for the ability to be able to hear that beautiful music. Thank you, Lord, for this time together, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, you can go ahead and finish passing that around, and I'll go ahead with the announcements there on there. First of all, next Sabbath will be, our offering will be for Kentucky Tennessee Advance. And then Thursday evening, 6:30, we are studying Acts. And so if you can come, we get together in the fellowship hall and meet for just Bible study. It's just right straight out of the Bible. And you never know who might have a different thought than what you have. And so if you can do that. There's a women's retreat at Indian Creek Camp, and that is September 9 through 11. And if you need more information, there's the website down there at the bottom. There will be an international food fair, and I want you to note this. It says this Sunday, August 28 at 4 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall at Tullahoma SDA Church. Ron. That's what it says. I'm just reading what it says. It's a fundraiser for the church school and a social event for the church members. But it's a lot of fun. you'll get to maybe taste some food that you've never tasted before. And speaking of food, there's a fellowship meal today. So make yourselves at home. It's in the fellowship hall, and I know there will be plenty. There always is. May God bless you as you lead a church. And I do have another one. Yes. It's on my phone. It says, it's time for the Deckard Diaper Derby once again, starting next Sabbath. And for the whole month of September, we will get to help Life Choices and their clients who are parenting babies and toddlers by bringing diapers and wipes to church. And after the month is over, these will be delivered to Life Choices. They have a great need for all sizes, but often run short of the larger sizes of diapers. What a blessing it is to help those facing an unintended pregnancy and to support them as they choose life for their babies. So that will be starting this next Sabbath. Okay, so let's not forget that we've always done well here for the diaper derby. So I anticipate that we will again this year. Thank you, Kathy, for bringing that to our attention. May God bless you as we go and fellowship with our fellowship meal now. You're dismissed. Thank you for coming, each and every one. God bless you.